back.
Should I say tadaima?
Tadaima.
Nowadays, those things actually matters more than just the academic aspects.
They shaped us as an adaptable
person.
So if
you say shape your world,
yeah.
You took risk, you innovate, and then you deliver.
We heard that you're really famous for your beautiful voice and that... Viewers of APUINATV, back again with our KataKita segment. My name is Zena, I'll be your host today, hosting a very special man coming all the way from Indonesia to Japan. He is a man to look up to, former World Bank Infrastructure Economist, Chief Business Development of State-Owned Enterprise, PT Penjamin Infrastruktur Indonesia, and former Regent of Trenggalek Regency. Now he is currently serving as the Vice Governor of East Java. He is our very own Bitsumikan APU Alumni, let's welcome Bapak Emil Dardak. Welcome, Pak. Welcome back to APU. How do you feel coming back?
Should I say tadaima?
Tadaima, yes, tadaima. Back to APU.
Yeah, it feels like many things haven't changed actually,
yes,
in the campus. And BEPU itself remains, you know, it has that very warm furusata kind of, not village type furusato, but really that, you know, it's your hometown sense. There's a sense of belonging,
yeah,
that I spent a number of years studying, yeah, here, and it left many fond memories, mm, definitely. So really, I'm really happy to be back in BEPU and, yeah, back in APU.
Yeah, we're really glad to have you here. So what was your favorite thing from BEPU when you were studying here?
What was my favorite part, yeah, of BEPU? Definitely I like the campus itself. This is, you know, the international community actually, yeah, makes settling in really easy. But we do love the hospitality of the Japanese people, the residents of BEPU, mm, as well. They are so welcoming.
Mm.
You know, having a lot of international residents, you know, aren't really easy, you know. There can be cultural clash, but
yes,
what happened in BEPU instead is was otherwise. I think we saw how the people of BEPU actually welcome us with very open hand, and that's what I like. I like the fact that the air is fresh and it's not crowded. It's not really, you know, the business of metropolitan, yeah, areas. You don't sense it here. But at the same time, shops remain open until late at night. You have 24 hours restaurants, you,
yes,
know, and I don't have to mention the eateries, the name, because,
yeah,
but there's plenty of nice food. I enjoy going to the karaoke,
oh,
with my friends. Yeah. And so many things that, you know, we can do in BEPU. The parks are adequate, and also in the campus itself. I think so many, what, you know, let's say that BEPU is pleasantly, you know, not so busy, but not quiet at the same time.
Not
so it's vibrant enough because of the student body,
yeah,
and the attractions, but at the same time, it's not so crowded that you feel that very peaceful feeling being here.
It's a really indeed a good place,
yeah,
to study for us,
yeah,
yes. So when did you actually first came to APU? You were taking master's degree, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, so I did my first degree in a program validated by the University of Wales, United Kingdom.
Yes.
And prior to finishing the degree, I came across APU from one of the posters that I saw in one of the campus in, mm, Indonesia.
Yeah.
So I decided to browse and then apply, and the admission representative in Indonesia was very helpful. They're also responsive to emails, and I was able to gain admission during the spring entrance. So,
okay,
because my program finished in December, January. So I rather, you know, I was, you know, I chose not to wait until fall,
yeah,
where most of the universities in United States and Europe
enrolled,
actually admit students. I decided to go to APU. One of the reasons is because it has spring entrance.
Okay.
So, but also because I was impressed by the concept that the university is bringing, the international concept. You know, everybody in Indonesia,
mm-hmm,
they're so impressed with Japan as a country. They believe that Japan has a very advanced education system. But the fact that now you can actually study in Japan, but also gain the international exposure, the international faculty members, international student body, having it done in English, is definitely a big factor for making me decide to go to APU.
Okay. Yeah, I guess like that's been one of the perks of going here. You have friends from all over.
And also you can, it's a compact study.
Yeah.
You can do it over a year.
Yeah.
And I managed to do my PhD over 2 years.
Yeah, it was such a surprising.
So it's one of the key attracting factor for me to study in APU.
Okay.
So and also I heard that living costs in BEPU is affordable.
Yeah, they say it's relatively the same as much, in Jakarta.
Yeah, much lower compared to the big cities in Japan.
That's true, especially like for the apartments here, people, it's really cheap when you especially stay with
your roommates. That's what I'm going to try during my visit here. I'm going to try to enjoy some of the food.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So what major did you actually take when you were here?
I started with a Master of Science in International Cooperation Policy.
Yeah.
But I decided to focus on development economics.
Okay.
And I loved it so much because I had a wonderful, development economics lecturer named Dipendra Sinha.
Okay.
He's my TC supervisor. He already passed away, but he was very dedicated. He taught in United States. He's a fellow in a lot of universities around the world, and then he decided to be in APU, and he was my supervisor both for my thesis and my dissertation at PhD. He's very strong in econometrics, statistics, and what makes the program special is it has a lot of relevance, and it draws upon a lot of experience from faculty members who served in international organizations like the World Bank, JICA, JBIC, JETRO, ADB, and we learn a lot about these development organizations, and that's where there is a uniqueness in this program called ICP, and the development economics aspect within it. But on the PhD itself also, I think it gives a lot of room for us to really explore. The access to journals are amazing. Academic journals are amazing, and I was able to really draw upon many literatures, but at the same time given the opportunity to explore outside the country. There was once I even participated in the annual Nikkei conference in Tokyo, where the speakers were head of states, like the Prime Minister of Singapore, Korea, Malaysia. So very prominent speakers, and those are some of the memorable aspects of my study in APU.
So that was, you were able to go to that conference because you were able
funded by APU, and so it was a great experience.
What did you gain from
definitely listening to discussions that featured prominent speakers like head of states. It's it can be considered a life changing experience. I was probably just barely 20 years old back then, and it's so inspiring, and probably it kind of helped me get to where I am right now.
So it does kind of like lead you to a path somewhere there.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So, I mean, like you mentioned before, some positive impact you gain from studying here in APU. Is there any like exact one thing that you think from the environment here in APU really affects you in how you make decisions right now in your career and how you lead East Java and etc.? Is there any specific like lesson that you think, oh, APU gave me this?
Well, definitely it gives you perspective. When you are inside the classroom, people from different countries give different perspective.
Yeah.
In the postgraduate program, what's great is the students, it's a combination of fresh graduates as well as people who are seasoned, who are already in the office, who've actually had professional working experience. So you have all these different perspectives, and it's really useful. One thing I also like about APU is they really organize many seminars, often bringing in speakers. Even I had a chance to meet with an author called Yoshihara Kunio, who authored a book called The Rise of Ersatz Capitalism. So it's a book about how capitalism in Southeast Asia, its pitfalls and how it hampered the true industrialization in Southeast Asia as compared to Eastern Asian countries like Korea, China and Japan. And we had prominent speakers coming from many, even
officers, in sitting officers, and that's why I came here, because I believe that now I have the opportunity to sit in a considerably interesting and challenging political position. I think I would like to share a bit of my story to the APU students. So it's a continuation of the benefits that I had when I was once a student here in APU. So that's what I think is really important, because when you get different perspectives, your paradigm widens. And you know, when you look at the same thing, but you have different lens looking at it. And also one thing that I really love about APU is that the multiculturalism, you know, is also effectively, you know, you find them, you meet with these multiculturalism outside classrooms.
Yeah.
Because the student activities are so vibrant within and also outside.
Yes.
So many times, because I love music, so I had a lot of opportunities to actually perform outside the campus.
Did you get to perform in Indonesian Week or any multicultural week?
Well, that's almost compulsory, because anyone who, you know, somehow I'm not really good at dancing.
Okay.
So to make myself useful, usually I play the instrument or at times. No, I didn't, well, once or twice I sang, but, you know, we divided the job, so I usually play the instruments more often than I sang. But outside the Indonesian community, I actually, once there's this, do you still have Tengku Sai Festival?
Yes, we do.
So there was once this APU songwriting competition, official song. So I made a band, members from the Philippines, Korea, and Japan, students, and then we won the grand prize. We got it recorded and got some good sum of money to do a lot of interesting music activities as well. Some of my band members, they actually went to Philippines and did some radio promotion.
Oh.
So it was really, really interesting time being a student here in APU. It's not just about studying, it's about the outside
people.
The classroom, which I believe nowadays those things actually matters more than just the academic aspects of the class.
Yeah, actually that's one of the thing that I remember the most. One of my professor actually said, like, right now it's about all the non-cognitive skills that you need to take and you need to learn here in APU. It's not all the cognitive skills that you need to learn, because they don't look at your academic transcripts anymore, they look at what you do. And that really motivates us here to really do a lot of things and circles and etc.
Yeah, I mean, we don't want people who simply regurgitate what's in the textbooks or in the literatures, but you want somebody who can synthesize and then produce something novel.
Yeah.
There's novelty, the originality of your ideas. But I think nowadays, especially in the millennial generation, you know, formality somehow crumbles, and people want more of the, you know, ideas that are not bound by conventional. It's not that we are departing from the wisdom, but it's more of we want more of the, you know, out of the box thinking taking place. And I believe that APU, which since its inception has focused and taken pride in being instead of a focus on a certain discipline, it focuses as a multidisciplinary university. Despite being APM or APS, you still
can take
are being
classes.
You know, sort of molded into somebody who is multidisciplinary. That's why regional or area studies are, I mean, a lot of the professors and faculty members here actually also do area studies. Asia Pacific is indeed a very important region in the world. The boundaries keep getting redefined, but the simplest thing that comes to our mind is ASEAN plus 3, for example.
Yes.
That means the three major Eastern Asian countries, and then you have the Southeast Asian countries, for example, and or even APEC countries, with adding America and some of the countries that face the Pacific Rim. But I don't think it's just the geographic entity, but Asia Pacific is, when the people say that the development is shifting from west to east, then you think about Asia Pacific.
Yes.
Yeah. So it really symbolizes how East is taking on the leadership in the global development now, and that's why then we want to have a better understanding about not only from an economic perspective, but also from the sociocultural. Because like, you know, I my first degree was from UK, and then I did another degree as well from Oxford. In the United Kingdom, for example, is famous for its pop culture,
yeah,
or sports or so on. Now, but when the pendulum shifts to the East, then we need to also define how, what, you know, like K-pop is, yeah, the most popular one, for example, Korean drama, yes, and we're seeing how it begins to even conquer the West. Mm-hmm. As an example, of course, I was a big fan of J-pop, of, yeah, Japanese pop singers, and J-Dorama was so big back then as well in Indonesia. I think these pop culture is an entertainment you cannot underestimate the importance, because when K-pop really emerged in Indonesia, we're seeing an influx of Korean restaurant establishments, brands coming in, the penetration of Korean brands increased significantly. Mm-hmm. These are the things that I think APU is well established for.
Yes.
I think the multiculturalism, multidisciplinary approach is what allows APU students and faculty members to really have the right perspective relevant to how the world is,
yes,
is shaping up today.
They shaped us as an adaptable
person.
So
if APU say shape your world,
yeah,
I think it's a bit you know, intriguing to know that back then, when, you know, shape your world has been APU's motto since I was a,
yeah,
student back in that 15 years ago,
mm-hmm,
so nearly two decades ago, this has been the motto. But I think it's becoming even more relevant today, is how we are shaping the world, not being shaped by the world.
No.
So you're not basically confined, mm-hmm, into the very narrow confinements of monodisciplinary approach in looking at things.
Yeah, I guess that's something really is special from APU. Okay, so actually I read a little about you before this, and I knew, I did some research, I knew that you wanted to actually be a professor from one of your interviews. So what made you actually shift your career, if I may say, or what made you change your career path in a sense?
Well, it hasn't really been a change of path, because,
mm-hmm,
I've you know, even during the course of my study, I was so happy that APU structured its, you know, academic year in a way that we can get exposed to a lot of activities outside the campus, like, you know, every 2 months break in between the 4 month semester, I can actually be engaged in consulting work that involves World Bank projects.
Okay.
So even after I received my PhD, I was working as a consultant, an infrastructure economist or financial specialist consultant in the bank, as you mentioned, the World Bank. So I've always been in that.
Mm.
But what kind of change is, I've always been in development.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's public sector.
Yeah.
It's not private sector per se. But when I decided to enter into electoral politics, where I need to be elected for office, that's where the whole politics is a bit different. So you know, that's where we call it practical politics, really becoming somebody who is, you know, running for an election is a very different experience compared with somebody who is, you know, working on a professional basis,
mm-hmm,
really getting into an appointed rather than elected position.
Mm.
So what got me there in Indonesia in 2000 and I think starting 2012 subsequent to that, there is a wave of incoming young political leaders, some people who actually went to study overseas and then work professionally decided to run into politics, and they won.
Mm-hmm.
It was unthinkable before for somebody who chose to be in a professional path,
mm-hmm,
to actually win an elected office. First of all, political parties are unlikely to nominate somebody who hasn't spent a long time being in politics. But for offices, entry-level elected office like mayors, I said entry-level not because it's, you know, of course you need to have experience and competence to become mayors. What I'm saying is, in the executive position, the only position that is for election is mayor and then governor and president. So at that mayor level, they welcome people from different backgrounds, including professionals who work in the office. It's kind of different for people who are entrepreneurs, because usually they don't have to quit their business when they're elected. The family can run it, although they maintain no conflict of interest. But or if you're a what do you call it? Maybe in a certain professions, you know. But for me, I was working for a state-owned enterprise as the chief business development of the guarantee fund. Guarantee PT Pinjaminan is guarantee fund. So I have to resign a career that has been going since I was part-time working in 2001, following my diploma of commerce, until 2015. So it's a tough decision, but you know, political parties are beginning to open their to open up opportunities for people who haven't been in politics to participate in election. But they need to do some of the legwork to see whether you get that. They call it so when you actually start introducing yourself to the people, you will actually they will actually observe whether your polls number increase. And that's why they decided to nominate me, because they see that there is a positive trend in the poll numbers, and then they, you know, seven political parties decide to nominate me because they said that the Trenggalek, which is the municipality that I was leading in the and participating in the election in 2015, wanted somebody new, wanted somebody younger, maybe coming actually from professional background to lead the municipality, the region. So there I was. So I spent my weekends actually flying to Trenggalek because I work in the capital city in Jakarta. So I fly every weekends, and then I meet the people, and then they observe my polls, and then at some point then I have to resign and participate in the election. And we won. We won. It was a good number. We had nearly 77% of the votes. But then, you know, I was subsequently asked by many seniors in the Indonesian politics, considering what I've done over the past 2 years as the region mayor of Trenggalek. I had a chance to speak at the United Nations Habitat Tree Conference in Quito. It's once every 20 years, and about 30 or 40 local government leaders were selected, because I was also elected as the co-president of the Asia Pacific Association of Local Government Leaders. The election was done in South Korea in 2016. Following that, then I was given a chance to also speak, and I was able to convey my message that climate change is important. It's not just a myth, and local governments are, you know, playing an important role, not only in climate change but in any aspects. I just recently came from OECD in Paris as one of the speakers. And we talk about how public investments worldwide are increasingly now being done at the local government level. They call it subnational level. So that's how I went into politics. And then they saw what we did, and then we won a number of awards when we based on the developments that took place in Trenggalek, and how we managed to actually turn the financial report from into and a report that is now accepted by the auditor, while previously there were notes. It's not an accepted audit report. And also we managed to actually improve the economy, develop innovations, and then awards in terms of maintaining city cleanliness, and then creating economic opportunities, and then development of new infrastructures are taking place. So that's why then they wanted me to look at something larger, but Trenggalek is still within that picture, which is East Java province. So that's why I was asked to run as vice governor. And apparently somehow also at the provincial level, they are hoping to get people, not without experience, but with certain experience, but fresh enough to deliver a change to the paradigm.
I knew that you're actually one of the youngest mayor in Indonesia, and then has it always been actually easy? Because like you say, people wanted some fresh air, fresh new people. Actually, being young, was it an advantage for you to gain some respect or like some trust from your people, or was it actually something that you really need to work hard to gain because being new in the area? How was it?
Well, being young can be a handicap because in a bureaucracy, then you are leading people who are more senior than you. In terms of winning an office or election, being young can be seen as being inexperienced. But it was kind of different because I spent nearly 15 years, right, doing. So the debates were really important because those were the moments when I can actually convey my experience, what I've done when I was working on World Bank projects and the Guarantee Fund with the Ministry of Finance, and also what I did in Trenggalek, which don't look at just, you know, like, I mean, experience is not about the number of years, but it's about the quality of your work during those periods. Somebody can work longer, but have they really made an impact? You may work shorter, but you took risk, you innovate, and then you deliver. So it's really changing that mindset, that that's what was there. So being young can be a handicap. Being young can be an advantage because people think that you're fresh, but it doesn't guarantee you, because there are things like, you know, they do debates, and then you have to campaign, you have to show that being young means you have ideas. You cannot say choose me because I'm young. You have to say these are my ideas, these are some of the reforms and progressive moves that I'm going to make should I be elected in office. These are some of the things that I've actually done, so that it's not just empty promises. I think being young gives you that advantage, but doesn't conclude the whole deal.
Well, that's really nice. So, I mean, above all of your experiences here and there, what is your message to us? What is your message to the younger generation, maybe especially Indonesians here in APU, or maybe to just all younger generations in general? What is your message for them? What do you want them to do here to make a difference, or what's the next step do you want us to make, or to make a difference?
Well, I think first of all, some people say that, you know, when you are young, it's not yet your time to be doing anything. I think that paradigm has to change. But it doesn't mean also that because then we rush in doing things. So, you know, it's a very thin red line between rushing and not delaying, you know. So it's not necessarily delaying. You have to really live the moment that, you know, there is an art into then seeing whether, you know, you should begin taking actions, or, you know, then just take the moment and not have to rush it through. So during your time in college, for example, I think it's really the right time to enrich the perspective. What matters when you enter into the next real world are your connections, your friends, your networks. The network is really important. And the multicultural perspective, you can't get that intentionally, or you cannot manufacture it. It's actually coming from the sincere interactions that you have with your friends. So I believe that, you know, when somebody talk about their lives in college, they don't really talk a lot about the classrooms.
They talk about the lives.
Yeah, and that's what makes anyone's life meaningful. So I would really encourage the young generation to enjoy the moment. Enjoy doesn't mean that you then basically not pursue or put in effort. What I'm saying is really try to do your best in whatever it is. If you're engaged in extracurricular activities, then give your best. In class, give your best. Even by being friends, give your best. What I'm saying, giving best, is be a good friend. Be a great friend. Because that's what's gonna make your life meaningful. I think then when you have that framework in life, you'll start with the right
attitude and character that the world, you know, really need right now. I don't think the world now realize that it's not competition that makes the world better. As such, it's co-creation. I just came from a fellowship in MIT in 2017, and we learned about co-creation. We learned about how you know, creativity is no longer an individual product. It's a collaborative product. Mm-hmm. But there is a barrier as to how somebody can cross the communication barrier. Mm-hmm. So that we learn about four levels of communication, the simplest being downloading, where people talk but you don't really care about what they actually say. Mm. It's like just asking, is it good weather today? And then that's all. And then you don't realize that you actually met somebody and asked that. The second is debating. You do listen, but it's about getting your point across. Uh-huh. It's not getting something from somebody you're speaking, but just about winning or losing. The third one is really about reflective, looking at the past and then trying to have an objective view. Mm-hmm. But the fourth level is what they call is pre-sensing. This is what Odo Sharmer, one of the professor in the Sloan School of Management in MIT, is teaching us, is being present and sensing the future. So the challenge is, how do people actually trust each other to determine the future path? Mm. Now, I believe that APU is well designed for that. I believe that when students actually try to break the cultural barriers, they establish trust. Mm. And I think, what are the three? Peace, freedom, humanity, is it?
Peace, freedom, and humanity.
And humanity. The three founding principles are really important. Mm. Because I think when you have peace, when we appreciate freedom, respect freedom, so it's freedom that stands on the foundation of respect.
Yes.
It's not freedom to encroach upon some other people's, you know, life. It's freedom. It's a responsible freedom. Mm-hmm. And peace, harmony, and humanity. That irrespective of your background, everybody wants goodness in their heart. And if these three foundations can be really embedded in our lives, then we can actually cross and break down the barriers, and we can collaborate better, and then we can create ideas together instead of being smart on our own. Because being smart on your own is not sufficient for the future. And I hope the young generation will become more collaborative, will have the courage to take risk, will have the desire to keep being innovative, and will also basically be savvy with the development in the digital era. Yeah. So we call it IDEA, IDE, innovative, digital minded, and entrepreneurial, and also be collaborative, have the character to become a part of a society
that is larger than our own.
Exactly.
Then again, I heard that the best source of knowledge that you can get is actually people. So
exactly, it's wisdom. You know, at the end of the day, it's not being smart but being wise.
Yeah, okay. Some really good good points to take notes of.
Yeah.
I guess last but not least, to close our segment today, we heard that you're really famous for your beautiful voice, and that. Yeah, and you mentioned before that you entered a competition with APU.
That's one thing great about APU, because when I was in APU, it gave me so much time to explore my musical interests.
Yeah,
and then I came back home, and then I met people who are professional in the industry, and then we recorded a single that actually did well in the radio charts. So yeah, but you know, one thing is I love Japanese songs actually. I'm not so good at reading Japanese characters, but I know enough to survive in the karaoke place to read the furigana or even some of the key kanjis that often appear in the songs. I don't know whether it's still the same, because now I was here 15 years ago, so singers like Misia, Hiraiken, Nakashima, Mika, those were singers that I listened to back then.
Could you please share a little and sing for us?
Well, this was the song that I sang in the farewell party of the Japanese Consulate General in Surabaya. It's a beautiful song by Nakashima, Mika. I think it's called Yuki no Hana.
Okay.
I don't know whether you still know that song. It's a snow flower. Let me just try to sing the chorus.
Of course.
I hope I'm remembering it. Kotoshi saisho no yuki no hana futari orisote nagamete iru kono toki ni shiawase ga afure dasu amae to kayowasa janai tada kimi o aishiteru kokoro kara so omota.
Whoa, big hand for viral. Oh my god, that was such a beautiful song that you sing, a beautiful voice from you.
It's a great song. I love it so much. Yeah, but
was it hard for you to memorize like the Japanese?
Yeah, because it's been a while. I usually sing it with some of the lyrics there, but yeah.
But you still remember that track. Yeah. So once again, thank you very much for your time today. It is a
big pleasure.
Yeah, it is a big pleasure for us to have you here and to meet such an inspiring person. All the best for you.
Thank you.
For your career and everything. And would you like to say some last few words to our viewers?
Again, thank you. My pleasure being back in Beppu in APU. And I'm impressed with how the campus has developed, how the creativity, both the Indonesian students as well as students from other countries. I saw the Thais practicing for the Thai week. You know, it's just good to see these good traditions get sustained, but develop in terms of the creativity. We're seeing new ideas coming in. So again, thanks. It's my pleasure to be here. And I always look forward to homecoming to Beppu in future.
Thank you very much once again. So with that, to all viewers of APUINA, have a great week and stay happy. Stay tuned for our next video. Thank you.